Now, to today's event. As you know, Judge Woo Kwok-Hing was the first one to throw himself in the race to the top job, and we're delighted to host him today. We haven't confirmed the other three, four, but we're very happy to have Judge Woo with us today. Woo Kwok-Hing was born about 50 years before the handover. He studied law in England. He returned to Hong Kong in 1970. He became Queen's Counsel and then joined the judiciary and served respectively as High Court Judge, Court of Appeal Judge, and Vice President of the Court of Appeal. Then he retired in 2012. And following his retirement, he returned to the judiciary to serve as Deputy High Court Judge until the date that we all know, the 18th of October, when he decided to devote himself full-time to the coming up election. Judge Woo is well known for speaking his mind, even on the record, he told us. So please welcome him to our microphone.
Friends, ladies and gentlemen, let's face it, this is the strangest of elections. For the longest time, I was the only candidate from October to 27th. I had no one to debate. My potential competitors were stuck at the traffic light, waiting for signals. One of them may be colorblind, as he was said to be ignoring a red light. All we know is that he waited and waited, reading a lot of Shakespeare, ruminating every now and then for a long while to run or not to run. You certainly can't blame our candidates for being overzealous. Originally, I was seeking to unseat the incumbent. But while he busied himself laying the groundwork for his re-election campaign, he suddenly changed his mind. For Hong Kong, Christmas came early on December the 9th. I understand he's a loving father, and I noticed that he's looking very happy and relaxed these days. Of course, we don't know whether he's going to pull a Putin on us. Another opponent says she would not run in order to spend time with her family, but was forced to reconsider. Maybe she was just concerned that the other candidates might not be quite up to the job. I guess somebody has to leave to save Hong Kong from any constitutional crisis or international embarrassment. That's what she said. While I'm learning to be a politician, this competitor is apparently learning how to live like the rest of us. As of last week, she hadn't mastered the use of the octopus card, nor learned where to find toilet paper in Hong Kong when it was most needed. But she's really good at guarding secrets. She can navigate any rules to prevent you from finding out what she's up to, and she's very proud of it. This election is strange in other ways too. After I announced my bid, people kept hounding me for my platform. 2.5 months later, my opponents joined the contest with no platforms, and electors can't wait to show them their support. Things change though, so you never know. We keep seeing supporters change sides. It seems that people are really confused about who should they vote for, as they are not sure who is going to win. Now, it's just like backing a horse. They want to choose the person who is winning, the horse that is winning. I've noticed that some people are more interested in knowing who my backers are than what I stand for. So, jokes aside, what do I stand for? And why am I running? I'm running because I see conflicts in and decline of my beloved city. I see political stagnation, people not living well, businesses suffering because of rising costs, and deep division in society. Hong Kong is getting so expensive. People are cooped up in small flats for which they are paying through their nose. We have more university graduates than ever, but it's so difficult for them to move ahead in society. To finance their studies, many have incurred large debts. The prospects of them repaying their debts, finding a decent job, and one day owning their own homes are frankly quite dim. Then there are the underprivileged who are subsisting on piecemeal subsidies and struggling to put a roof over their head. We have nearly 300,000 people waiting in line for public housing. The backlog has lengthened from 3 to 4.5 years. In the meantime, some 200,000 people are living in subdivided flats, some of them in industrial buildings, in appalling conditions. The middle classes feel insecure, and small businesses are squeezed by high rents and low margins. Ironically, it so happens that all three of my competitors, I'm only talking about the main competitors, all three of my competitors, they were all veteran senior officials at one point or another, have a hand in creating the malaise. They are all part of the status quo. I was a judge, but I was not a government man. I represent change, and change is what is needed at this juncture. It's been almost 20 years since the handover. Our laws are antiquated and inadequate. The political parties refuse to compromise. The legislature is paralyzed, and we must suffer incompetent top officials. Vested interests remain unchecked. Our system is broken. I have 2022 vision. Yes, it is better than 2020 vision. Why 2022? Because I'm only aiming to be a one-term chief executive. I hope the next chief executive will be elected by one man, one vote, universal suffrage. I have a vision and would like to set the agenda for every Hong Kong resident to consider. I've started my journey since I declared my candidacy on October the 27th. I promised to give it my best shot all the way to the end. the support of the public and the electors will determine how far I can go towards fulfilling my wish, my mission. I promise to appoint the best people based on their merits. I have no political baggage, no favors to repay. I can be totally impartial and invite people with different political leanings and from all walks of life to join my administration. I will lead an open and transparent government. But it is not enough to have good people. We need to have the right checks and balances. Right now, too much power is vested in the chief executive. And the system of a small circle election doesn't give the CE a mandate from the people. My platform's main priority is to revisit political reform. You know that LegCo failed to pass any bill on political reform in 2014. Now, my proposal is very simple, and entirely, as I'm a lawyer, as I'm a judge, entirely in accordance with Article 45 of the Basic Law. If I may read a passage from Article 45, it says, the method for selecting the chief executive shall be specified in the light of the actual situation in the Hong Kong Special Administrative Region and in accordance with the principle of gradual and orderly progress. The ultimate aim is the selection of the chief executive by universal suffrage upon nomination by a broadly representative nominating committee in accordance with democratic procedures. Now, by the next election, the chief executive will be elected by the one man, one vote, universal suffrage. The main idea, my idea, is to increase the number of voters for the nominating committee. Presently, the election committee consisting of 1,200 members. The electoral basis of this committee will have to be widened from the current 250,000 voters to 1 million by 2022, and eventually to 3 million voters, or 3 million plus voters later, and that is Hong Kong's entire electorate. Then you need 1/8 of all the members of the nominating committee, that is, as a present, 150 nomination votes to get nominated. Now, I need 150 votes to get nominated to run for the election. Now, my proposal is that these numbers can be more, can be less, but the principle is there. And how many or how few will have to be decided upon after consultation. If this proposal of mine is endorsed by 2/3 majority of LegCo members and acceptable to the public in Hong Kong, public of Hong Kong, we can submit the proposal for the central government's approval. It has been said that nothing has changed since we failed to pass any political reform proposal last time, that is in 2014, and that we will be banging our heads against the wall for trying. That's one of the candidates said that. But CY Leung will be going quite soon. It is a clear signal from the central government that times have changed. We should look forward rather than backwards. If we don't try, we will never know, let alone change. There are many who question whether the one country, two systems is still being eroded. This election, for instance, has been plagued by all kinds of traffic-like interpretations and rumors of influence peddling. Public perception of behind-the-scenes maneuvers by mainland officials cannot easily be dismissed. I believe the best way to address the issue is to enact legislation according to the provisions of Article 22 of the Basic Law. I'm not talking about Article 23 yet. I'm talking about Article 22. Article 22 reads as follows. I just need to read the first paragraph. No department of the Central People's Government and no province, autonomous region, or municipality directly under the central government may interfere in the affairs which the Hong Kong SAR administers on its own in accordance with this law. That means no mainland departments or the central government or representing the central government or any provinces shall interfere with the affairs, the internal affairs that Hong Kong manages itself. Now, that's for sure. That's Article 22. But how about if somebody were to ignore this law? He or she would be in breach of the Constitution of Hong Kong, the Basic Law. But where is the punishment? No punishment. What is going to happen to such a man? Nothing. That's why we have to make a law criminalizing such acts, interfering with the internal affairs of Hong Kong, as a crime and punishable under Hong Kong law, punishable by the courts in Hong Kong. Now, this will strengthen our legal basis for safeguarding the implementation of two systems. We need two systems. Two systems, the Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong. That's including a high degree of autonomy for Hong Kong and Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong. Now, once we have a consensus for going forward with the political reform I propose, the conditions may be ripe for us to propose legislation according to the stipulations of Article 23, which prevents treason, subversion, etc. Now that's Article 23, I think everybody knows about it. If we do not enact local legislation to safeguard the premises of one country, now this is, Article 23 is to protect one country, not the two systems. Article 22 protects the two systems. Article 23 protects the one country. Well, if we don't make legislation ourselves, we shall run the risk of the central government or the mainland using Article 18 of the Basic Law to impose national legislation on us through Annex 3 to the Basic Law. Now, Article 18, perhaps I'll read a bit of it. Yes, the third paragraph or the third provision or under Article 18 is this. The Standing Committee of the National People's Congress may add to or delete from the list of the laws in Annex 3 after consulting its committee for the Basic Law of the HKSAR and the government of the region. Now, Annex 3 is all the national laws that are applicable to the HKSAR. Now, as we are on the issue of legislation, being a lawyer, I always talk about the law. And please bear with me. Let me draw your attention to the two other ordinances that I believe need to be reviewed. There are sections in the Prevention of Bribery Ordinance which do not apply to the chief executive. putting him above the law. And this, where's my, haven't got it. These are sections 3 and 8 of the Prevention of Bribery Ordinance. These provisions prohibit any public officer from receiving money from anybody while he is in public office. But the CE is exempted from these two sections. That means these two sections do not apply to the chief executive, while other civil servants are prohibited from receiving money, the CE is not. How absurd can that be? Now, by making these two sections apply to the CE, we make the law equal to the CE as to other people. And that actually reflects the wording and spirit of Article 25 of the Basic Law. Article 25 reads, all Hong Kong residents shall be equal before the law. Now, very simple, just one sentence in Article 25. And that is the crux of the rule of law. Everybody shall be equal before the law. Nobody is above the law. And without that, there cannot be a rule of law, because the rule of law, one of the main requirements is that everybody shall be equal before the law. If somebody is above the law, it's no good. Now, that's why I say making sections 3 and 8 applicable to the CE will be of paramount significance if the rule of law is to be upheld. Now, then there's the university ordinance under which the chief executive is vested with wide powers, like appointment of the head of the governing council and so on. Now, this should be dealt away with, because colonial governors only exercise their powers under the ordinance, the university's ordinance, very sparingly, and he would act only as a sort of ceremonial head to the universities, not somebody who's exercising powers to affect university autonomy or academic freedom. No, he can't do that. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if you bear with me for a further moment, I've one more proposal to make about to improve Hong Kong's administration, which is by introducing the archive law in Hong Kong. If with the archive law being in force, the matters concerning or the saga of the Wang Chao incident will not appear, would disappear. Nobody dares to break the law, not to have records of what was going on. You remember the Wang Chao saga, the chief executive says there's no record of the soft lobbying, discussing with the villagers and so on, and eventually the making of the decision to reduce the originally planned 17,000 units to 4,000 units, forgetting or adjourning forever the 13,000 units that was planned to be built. Now, if I may recap, I've set out the changes I shall make in the upcoming 5 years. The world is changing, with Brexit and Donald Trump becoming the US president. We in Hong Kong are catching up. Siva Leung, to everybody's delight, was axed. The central government obviously did not like him to carry on. This encourages the thinking that China wants change. We've had Hong Kong run by a businessman, then by a civil servant, and then by a professional. Do you see the change is imminent? With the support of the election committee members and the Hong Kong public, I shall have a chance to implement my 2022 vision, and I'm sure Hong Kong will be a much better and happier place. Thank you.
Ben Bland from the Financial Times. Do you think that the 1,200 members of the election committee have a free choice? And would you therefore characterize this as an election or a selection by Beijing? Thank you.
The 1,200 members of the election committee actually have the duty also to nominate. And unless a person gets one-eighth of their number for nomination, he won't even get into the gate for the CE election. And you may say that that's a selection process. But if actually the electoral basis for the election of the 1,200 members is widened to say all the electors in Hong Kong, territory-wide, then there's not much difference from other proper elections. And that's why, for the time being, you can call it a selective process. But if it is widened in accordance with my proposal, then it will not. It will be a proper election.
On a clear point, do you think the 1,200 members have a free choice, or is this simply a process in which the majority of them instructed what to do by Beijing? I mean, it's a really important point for the media and for Hong Kongers to understand, clearly, not about the nomination, but the vote. Is this a free vote, or is this just a process in which 600 plus one are told what to do, and therefore the campaign and everything else to the public is irrelevant? It's only Beijing's decision that counts.
It's not irrelevant. I mean, the public's idea is not irrelevant. The public opinion is not irrelevant. As far as I can see it, there are two processes through which a candidate has to go. One is the nomination process. Now, the nomination will have to be done openly with signatures of these 1,194 members. Now, this, you may say, as generally believed, will be subject to the scrutiny of the central government of Beijing or the mainland. Now, if you nominate the candidate and you show your name there, that means at least you are supporting this candidate in your nomination. That may not be in accordance with somebody else's idea, and that will be known, and that's no good. That's the control there. But after the nomination, the election process is by secret ballot. Nobody will know whether you have voted for one or the other. Now, that remains its merit. That's important. Secret ballot is very important. And that is where some changes can be made. Right? Yes.
Yes, Ed.
Judge Wu, Edward Chin. FCC Press Freedom Committee member. Now, if you were elected as chief executive, would you immediately drop charges against the four pandemic legislators now being DQ, disqualified by CY's administration?
Will I review it?
Drop the charges.
Ms. Chin, apparently you're not a lawyer. Those... those cases,
the cases are JR cases.
The government, or actually the government as represented by the S4J, the Secretary for Justice, is a civil case. That's a civil case. And the plaintiff, we have plaintiff and defendant in the civil case. The plaintiff is represented by the S4J. Now, when the S4J has taken out an action on behalf of the government, because of the independent decision of the S4J, it is for him to decide whether the case should be carried on or not. I mean, he may take into account, for example, public interest. He may take into account matters which which are very important for any civil case to be carried on, which is the chances of success. Now, he must consider that sort of thing. As the CE, since the case has been taken out already, has been in the action box, put it that way, then the CE should not interfere with the independent decision of the S4J. Now, the S4J may decide one way or the other. Viewing and reviewing the circumstances connecting with the case. Now, that's what I'm going to say. I'm not going to interfere with the independent judgment of the S4J as a CE. Well, if I were the CE, I would not have brought the action myself. That's as far as I can go. But I should not interfere with the independent judgment to ask for Jay, because he's representing the government. He's the chief government counsel on every sort of thing, in fact. Right?
Thank you. Cliff Buddle from the SCMP.
Hello, Mr. Woo. You put forward today quite an ambitious program of legislative change. In order to bring about those changes, you're going to need support from legislators. Mm. How would you go about improving the relationship between the executive and the legislature so that legislation in these quite sensitive areas can be passed and amended?
A lot of these things are done through communications. Communications are important. You have to get the trust of the people with whom you are negotiating. If they don't trust you, there's no point going to negotiate with them at all. That's the defect of the present government. Legislators, or a lot of legislators, don't trust them. Secondly, regarding the relationship between the executive and the legislature, I think the present government is acting wrongly by not inviting representatives of political parties in LegCo, or the main political parties in LegCo, to be EXCO members. Now, you have to do that. You have to do that. You may hear opposing views. But that's, the purpose of EXCO is not only to hearing concurring views. You have to hear opposing views so that your policy is decided on a sound basis. You should have known of all the opposition voices, the reasoning behind, before you make a decision, a policy decision. And then you have that policy decision, once you have decided, to go down to LegCo for laws to be implemented, to be passed. But if you've got the representatives of the political parties in LegCo already agreeing in EXCO, how can they ask their members to oppose your bills? Right? It's that sort of thing. The present government's defect is they appoint EXCO members upon friendship, right? Not upon merit. Not dividing the power, in fact, dishing out the power to the right people, to opposing parties as well as consenting parties. You have to do that. Even for the umbrella movement, for example, for the youngsters who oppose to the government's deeds. And if you ask them, what do you want? Why are you occupying Central? Why are you occupying Queensway, they will say, we want universal suffrage. But nobody has ever mentioned about it. They have nowhere to vent their opinions, to vent their grievances. If they are listened to, if the CE were to go down to Queensway and talk to them, you see, sort of same level talking. You are the leader of Hong Kong. You talk to the leader of the students, same level. You don't treat them as being somebody lower. You see, you don't send along a phone key to talk to them. You go yourself to talk to them. And they will come up with the same idea. We want universal suffrage. Fine, you want universal suffrage. As the CE, I have a duty to report to the central government. I'll make a report to the central government as to what you want. If the central government were to buy your ideas, they'll say so. If they don't buy it, they'll give you some reasons, right? We'll just report back as a CE, you report back to the Hong Kong people the central government's ideas. If you can't, you can budge, for example. If you can't avoid it, fine. Then let the people know. But at least for the time being, people will disperse because they are satisfied with what you are going to do. And if they trust you, they'll disperse. It's the same sort of thing.
Thank you. Could I myself ask a question about Beijing's attitude towards your candidacy? Have you heard from them? And if yes, what did they say? Have you heard from Beijing?
Oh, no. I've in a way asked Beijing whether I should run or not. But that was a very early stage. And the response was no response. And I asked the chap through which I asked for the view of Beijing. And I say, isn't that the only proper response? No response. He says, no response to what you ask. No response. But recently, I went up to Shenzhen to see Director Wang Jiangya. And I've kept my promise not to divulge the conversation between us. But when I came down, I still carried on with my campaign. That's all I can say. Apparently, we can still go on. I'm running the election in accordance with Hong Kong law, in accordance with the basic law. And there's nothing against me.
Thank you. One more question here, the lady in front. Wait for the mic, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Wu, for your speech. But I would like to know, you know, whether you have some self-estimation about how good is your chance of getting nominated, first of all, that is to get into the gate, in order to realize your vision for all of us.
The chances of my getting sufficient nominations for getting through the gate, put it that way, they're saying getting into the gate. I'm quite confident that I'll get sufficient votes, nominations for that. But apparently, most of my support will be from the pro-Democrats, not from the pro-establishment. Because as that gentleman who asked me the first question suggests, that made the way. Somebody's pressing the button. I don't know, they call it pressing the button. They don't want to, the pro-establishment people don't want to expose their inclinations. Because they may, if they nominate you, their nomination may be wrong, may be said to be wrong, eventually. And that's why they avoid that sort of thing. And therefore, it's difficult to get open nominations. But with the Democrats, they know they can open their nominations. Apparently, the mainland will not care so much about how they are going to vote. You see, but that's important for me, because I need to get sufficient votes to get through the gate.
Florence, can I ask one more question?
Okay.
Judge Wu, being a judge in Hong Kong, it's quite different from being a judge in mainland China. Now, if you read the ICIJ report, a lot of judges, people in government, they amass a lot of wealth that's hidden in offshore companies, BVI, Cayman Islands, and whatnot. If you were elected, would you just become a puppet of Beijing? And if you don't really become one of them, you know, like you talk about defending Hong Kong's core values. So yeah. How do you do it?
Thank you, Mr. Chin, for giving me a chance to explain this sort of matter, which is the difference between the judicial system in Hong Kong and in Beijing. in China, in the mainland, the judiciary is but a part of the government. It's actually a department of government. And no matter how independent they are part of the government, serving the government. Which is quite different from Hong Kong. And people, several months ago, there were huge arguments about whether Hong Kong has got a separation of, in a Chinese way, three powers. But of course, in English term, there's no separation of three powers. There's only separation of powers, right? The judiciary, the legislature, and the executive. Now, Hong Kong's judiciary is most independent. If you look at the basic law, you'll find a lot of provisions proclaiming the independence of the judiciary. Now, so much so that, in fact, you look at the whole of the basic law, it seems that the judiciary is supreme, more supreme than the executive and the legislature. Although the Hong Kong political system is said to be executive-led. Now, we are very different from mainland judges. And I've never heard of a case of corruption of Hong Kong judges, not even magistrates. You see, you're quite sure about that. And that's why in Hong Kong, people respect the law. And it's not only respect for the law, it's respect for the rule of law. Everybody is equal before the law. And that's the basis. That's why I say the prevention of public, the prevention of bribery ordinance will have to be amended to make sections 3 and 8 applicable to the CE, so as to make everybody equal. Now, I can't think of a case of corruption of a Hong Kong judge. That's why you can rest assured that there's no such thing in Hong Kong, no corruption of judges in Hong Kong. And in fact, judges are used to deal with departments like the ICAC. I used to be the commissioner on interception and covert surveillance matters. I supervised and oversaw the operations of covert surveillance and interception of communications, the Chinese call "aoxin," supervising the operations by the police, by the ICAC, by the customs, and by the immigration departments. And they entrust this kind of job to judges. And now there are 3 judges in the High Court to sign the warrants, the orders, for allowing this sort of activity to go on by the police, by the ICC, and so on. And there's one commissioner, just like me, my successors, supervising the operations of the law enforcement agencies. Now, we're quite different. We're trusted, and we are trusted, I think, justifiably by people in Hong Kong.